Enviro Close-Up is made possible in part by a grant from Greensphere.
Building Green, next on Enviro Close-Up. Welcome to Enviro Close-Up. I am Carl Grossman. The subject, Building Green, with Alex Wilson. Alex Wilson is the president of Building Green Incorporated. He's the executive editor of the Environmental Building News. He's secretary of the board of the U.S. Green Building Council, and he's an author, a co-author, an editor of numerous books and manuals, including The Consumer's Guide to Home Energy Saving, something which we all need. Hello, Alex.
Hello, Carl. Great to meet you.
A pleasure. For starters, when we talk about building green, what do we mean?
Well, it's a way of designing and building structures, be it houses or commercial buildings, institutional buildings, that looks at the overall environmental impacts of those buildings. And a whole range of impacts from indoor air quality for the people living in those buildings to resource use to energy consumption and water consumption of those buildings. It's really a way of thinking about buildings, and it's an integrated approach. You know, back in the 70s, there was a strong movement toward solar energy and renewable energy. And the green building movement grew out of that, but it takes a broader exposure to that, looking at not only energy and not just renewables, but the whole range of issues.
Now, how did you get into this field?
Well, it was kind of a circuitous route. My background is actually in biology. I have a degree from Ithaca College in biology. And in the mid-70s, got involved with renewable energy work in Ithaca, New York, with a group of students, a project funded by the National Science Foundation. And one of the people who had been involved with that group ended up in Santa Fe, New Mexico, working for a solar energy organization, the New Mexico Solar Energy Association. And she suggested I should come out there and begin working with them. At the time, I was working in Washington, D.C., and kind of ready to get out of the city. So headed down to Santa Fe, got this position, and spent the next 2.5 years teaching people about solar energy by leading hands-on workshops. We were primarily looking at solar greenhouses, but also solar water heaters, a system called a trome wall that the mass of the wall heats up and warms the home in that way. But I did that for 2.5 years and then accepted the directorship of a similar organization in Brattleboro, the New England Solar Energy Association. It's now the Sustainable Energy Association, the Northeast Sustainable Energy Association, and it's based in Greenfield, Massachusetts. But with that organization, I came in 1980, right at the period Ronald Reagan was elected, and one of the first things that happened was a loss of the federal funding that had supported that organization really since its founding. So we had to really shift gears, and we broadened the focus away from just solar to look at all issues of energy, and we really focused in on building, how to design buildings to reduce energy use, but also how to create better buildings, quality buildings. And at that time, I began doing a lot of writing for various publications. And 5 years later, when I left that organization in 1985, I went out on my own as a writer. And at this time, I was writing for Architecture Magazine, the Journal of Light Construction, Custom Builder, Popular Science, a bunch of different magazines. And I would always try to really get into articles that focused on the environment. That's really where my love was. But most of the writing I did was on building technology issues. Some of them related to energy, but you know, all kinds of articles. Then in 1989 or 90, I can't recall exactly when, Architecture Magazine did a special issue on green architecture. I wrote several of the articles for that piece, and they were well received. And I began thinking about whether there might be a niche out there for a publication focused specifically on green design and green building. So that was the kind of the origin of that idea. It took a couple of years to build up courage and learn enough about publishing to try to make a go of it. And we launched the publication Environmental Building News in 1992.
Alex, could you describe your magazine?
It's a monthly publication targeted toward architects, builders, developers, building product manufacturers. And it covers all these issues that we collectively describe as green building, from the land use planning issues, how to design communities, how to create spaces where people aren't as dependent on automobiles, to energy design, to water, to indoor air quality, to material selection. And in each issue, we're a little different from most newsletters, which, you know, provide little snippets of news about whatever the topic is. We take an issue, take a topic in each issue, and really dig into depth on that. So we might focus on biodiesel that can be used as a heating fuel and also as a transportation fuel, and really go into depth about what biodiesel is, why it might be a significant topic for architects and builders. But we really, you know, go into a lot of detail on that topic. Then the newsletter also includes product reviews, what we describe as green building products. We review resources, new books and periodicals and websites that are coming out. We write about news that's affecting the green building industry. And occasionally we'll stick in an editorial, an opinion piece from our editors.
You have a pretty big circulation for that niche.
Well, it's not as big as I'd like it. I'd like to think that there were more people out there who really cared about the environment. I think it's changing. There are more people now getting interested in it. But, you know, we're reaching a community of 100,000 architects out there and hundreds of thousands of builders and developers. And we just have a small niche of that. We go out to about 5,000 architects and builders. We have wider circulation, if you will, through the internet, but you know, we can't provide everything for free. So our internet resource is partly a subscription-based resource and partly free.
Now, you're also active on, as I mentioned, the U.S. Green Building Council. Describe what that is.
Sure. The U.S. Green Building Council is a relatively young organization. It was founded in 1993. It's a very quickly growing organization and really the only organization of its kind in the country. It's focused on green building. It's a broadly based organization with members ranging from architecture firms to building product manufacturers to big construction firms. The initial focus had been on commercial building, and that's still where the primary focus is. Office buildings, institutional facilities, manufacturing facilities, but it's branching out into other areas, including residential. It's an organization that's been growing at a tremendous pace. When I joined the organization in 1996, there were less than 200 members. Today, we've just surpassed the 4,000 mark. And these are companies. Individuals don't join the organization. Companies do, or agencies or organizations. And really the most unique thing about the U.S. Green Building Council is its diversity. You know, bringing into the same discussion environmental groups like the Natural Resources Defense Council with huge manufacturers like Carrier Corporation. These are entities that never used to really communicate, and they've united in the U.S. Green Building Council in this forum to bring about change in the building industry. So it's a very exciting organization to be a part of.
But in terms of support of what you're about, there was a very telling editorial you wrote in the Environmental Building News, let's see, October 2002, wishing for a can-do attitude. And here you write how after 9/11, the terrorist attacks on the United States, President Bush could have declared that the nation was going to work together not only to protect our nation from the ravages of terrorism, but also to wean our nation from its dependence on oil. A Manhattan Project scale commitment to renewable energy could have at the same time reduced our dependence on the Middle East, reduced our inadvertent funding of terrorism via the Saudi Arabian oil pipeline. You go on and on and on. Bush could have, he could have been way up there on Mount Rushmore, you suggest, if he would have jumped at that point into promoting, pushing renewable energy, green energy, the kind of thing you're all about. But you say, tragically, he didn't. Can he, can this nation, this administration now, do the right thing?
Well, as I said in that piece, I think there was an opportunity, and I may have described it as a once-in-a-generation opportunity, to really bring about fundamental change, a real paradigm shift in the way we looked at energy and resources and consumption. I feel that a lot of the anger that's been directed at this country, and which I feel really fueled the 9/11 tragedy, directly relate to our profligate consumption of energy and resources. You know, here we have 6% of the world's population, we're consuming 30% of our energy. And a lot of people are resentful of that. And so I think we've seen this, this sort of terrorist act. I don't think it's the last one. And I feel that instead of mounting a militaristic action, or perhaps in addition to some sort of military action, we should really have focused on the root causes of these problems. And I feel fundamental with that is our dependence on fossil fuels. And I think a concerted effort, if we had taken the $100 billion that we've now put into the Iraq war and instead put that into a project on the scale of the Manhattan Project to create a renewable economy, I think we would have made tremendous strides in that within the span of 5 or 10 years. You know, one of our greatest resources in this country is the ingenuity and the dedication of Americans. And I feel that President Bush, right after 9/11, had this unique opportunity to have virtually the entire nation behind him. And, you know, he could have directed it in a very positive direction. And I feel that opportunity was missed. You know, yes, it'll come back. There will be other ways to do that. But, you know, it'll be hard to recapture that tremendous momentum that could have been there.
Well, it often becomes a matter then of what we can do. And as I had mentioned before, you wrote this interesting book, The Consumer's Guide to Home Energy Savings. Perhaps you might provide some recipes for people with homes, also people with apartments, as to what they could do to do things green and save money and help save the environment.
Sure. There are a huge number of opportunities there for homeowners to reduce their own energy bills and to reduce their contributions to environmental degradation. These range from replacing incandescent light bulbs with compact fluorescent light bulbs to upgrading their appliances next time they need to replace a dishwasher or a clothes washer, to choose the most energy efficient models out there, insulating their homes or tightening up their homes. You know, I live in a home built in the late 1700s. When I moved in here, there would often be a 20 or 30 degree difference in temperature between the floor and the ceiling. But simply by bringing in a specialist who could weatherize the house, we were able to dramatically improve our comfort and also dramatically reduce our energy costs. So there are many win-win solutions available with home energy savings. The book that I wrote with the staff of the American Council for an Energy Efficient Economy really directs people to these action items. And it's a great book. They've sold, 150 or 200,000 copies since the first edition came out, I believe in 1990 or 91. But it's the practical ideas that you and I can implement very easily right away.
And if one I mentioned before, a lot of people live in apartments and in urban areas. How could they do things green in their structures?
The challenges for apartment dwellers are a little greater because they don't own the structure and they don't want to spend a lot of their own money to fix it up and then move to a different apartment a year down the road and not be able to take that investment with them. But there are lots of things they can do. I mentioned the light bulbs, the compact fluorescent lamps that can replace incandescent light bulbs. And those you can take with you when you leave. But it's not just the buildings. And, with my work, I'm primarily focused on the buildings and, the homes and offices we live and work in. But we should also be looking at our transportation. And in terms of environmental impact, there are tremendous gains one can make by trading in that SUV or that older, inefficient automobile and highly polluting automobile for a much more energy efficient one. We have a hybrid Honda Civic that we drive, but also looking at transportation use in general. If you're in an urban area and there's potential for public transit, that's a great way to make a difference. I ride my bike to work 7 miles in the better weather, and unfortunately in Vermont I can't do that all the time, although some friends of mine ride year-round. But I ride in when I can, and I last year rode, I think, 500 to 1,000 miles commuting in the span of the season. So those are, things that anyone can do, whether homeowners or apartment dwellers.
And speaking of bigger buildings, public buildings, schools are, all our children go to schools. And you testified before, let me look here at your testimony, before the Environment and Public Works Committee of the United States Senate not long ago on high-performance school buildings. Describe what high-performance school buildings are, Alex.
Sure. High performance is another term that's sometimes used synonymously with green buildings. There tends to be a little bit more focus on energy, perhaps, when one uses the term high performance. But it really tries to be this broad brush approach that looks not only at energy consumption, but also at these other measures of performance. So a high performance school is one that keeps the students healthy, keeps the teachers healthy, improves productivity in the learning environment, reduces energy consumption, thus saving the school system money, saving the taxpayers money in the case of public schools. Material use in new construction or renovation of schools, it looks at what sorts of materials are selected and installed in that building. It looks at the operation of the building, the types of cleaning fluids, cleaning supplies, and the impacts of those materials. Many of our cleaning materials release huge amounts of volatile organic compounds, or VOCs, into the air. And those make some kids sick and increase absenteeism. So a high-performance school is one that, accounts for all of these issues and tries to minimize the environmental impact, maximize the energy performance of the school, incorporate strategies like daylighting that can, not only help to reduce energy costs of lighting, but also bring natural light into a building that might improve student performance. And actually, there's a great study that was done in California a few years ago looking at daylighting in schools. and they measured dramatic improvements in student performance on standardized test scores in classrooms that were naturally daylit as opposed to classrooms that were illuminated entirely by fluorescent lighting. I believe the numbers were a 20% improvement in math scores and a 26% improvement in verbal scores on standardized tests. And in California, the testing is such that they test at the beginning of the year and at the end of the year and measure the improvements in test scores during that course of the year. So it's possible to fairly easily factor out other parameters that might be contributing to those changes, such as income level or the location of the school. So anyway, high-performance schools, you know, perform very well. They keep people healthy. They raise the productivity of learning, and they improve the environment or reduce the negative impacts on the environment.
You write to a lot, in fact, in environmental building news about something called future-proofing your building. What's future-proofing your building, Alex?
Well, future-proofing is the idea of designing and building a structure that can be modified, that can be adapted to changing uses. You know, particularly in the commercial building arena, we know that that needs change. You know, the average office building dramatically modifies their layout every 5 or 6 years, you know, moving offices around, moving workstations around. Future-proofing is a way to think about that at the beginning, at the outset, to make it easier to make those modifications, not only costing less money, but using fewer resources and taking less time. And you know, reducing the amount of waste that's generated in that renovation work. In homes, future-proofing can be designing for changing needs. You know, if you think a mother-in-law might be moving in at a certain point, it's planning for that future addition or adaptation.
Alex, if somebody wanted to find a green builder, how would you go about that?
It's a good question. I would ask around in your area, ask builders whether they have an interest in green building, whether they've heard of it. A lot of people haven't heard of it. There are some websites. Doing a search on Google may come up with some lists. The website www.greenbuilder.com has a directory of builders that have interest in this, although I don't know how national that directory is. But basically asking around and calling up builders in the Yellow Pages and seeing what they have to say about energy efficiency or green building.
You also speak of numerous articles in the magazine about the challenge of water heating. That second you write to heating a home is heating the water that's used in that home. And you speak of many options. Perhaps you can tell us some of the options.
Sure. Water heating is a huge area, and it's one that's often ignored. There's been a huge focus on how we heat homes, but how we heat our water can, you know, often be the number two energy cost in a home. And you know, the primary options used today are natural gas or propane and electricity. Solar energy is an option for water heating, although that's used on a very small scale and in fairly limited parts of the country. There's potential to be using solar water heating a great deal more widely, but there are also ways to use the conventional fuels like natural gas, but do it in a much more efficient way. One of the strategies would be a demand water heater. This is a smaller water heater that heats water as that water is needed, instead of heating it and storing it in a tank that sits down in a basement or in a utility closet. A demand water heater turns on as you turn on the tap to bring water to the tap. And it reduces the standby loss, you know, that heat that is normally wasted by escaping through the walls of that tank. One of the other areas with water heating that a lot of people don't think about is the water waste that happens when you're waiting for hot water to reach your faucet or shower. You know, how many times have you turned on that hot water and then had to wait so long that you go do something else and, you know, wait for it to reach that tap? There's a great device that's come onto the market in the last 10 years. It's an on-demand circulator that takes the water that's been sitting in that hot water pipe and pumps it back into the water heater while hot water is brought to your faucet or shower very quickly. It has a little pump in it that moves the water much more quickly than the tap itself does. So it's a way both to bring hot water to your fixture very quickly, as well as reducing the water waste that normally happens when you let that water go down the drain. So that's just one of the ideas for improving the performance of a whole water heating system. Not just the heating of the water, but the distribution of that water as well.
Now, you've spoken about the failure of the Bush administration to do the right thing after 9/11, energy-wise, environment-wise, building green-wise. How can people, well, it might be a hopeless cause to get the current federal government to go in the green direction, but how could people best perhaps get their state governments, get the Congress, county and city and town governments, get their school districts to go in the direction of building green and all of what you've been crusading for so many years?
Well, that's a great question, Carl, and it's a challenging one. At the same time, the federal government isn't really playing the role that it should. The budgets have gotten tighter for everybody. You know, so the local school system in Brattleboro, Vermont, or the state government in Vermont, you know, they have less federal money to work with on bringing about changes. So it's really going to take a lot of ingenuity at all levels. And it's going to take activism on the part of the taxpayers and the people who are sending their kids to school, or the homeowners who want to reduce their own costs. And it's going to take a lot of creative solutions. But I guess I remain optimistic that that we can find those solutions. And I think that we're not going to see static energy prices for the rest of our lives. I think sooner or later, and probably a lot sooner than many people think, we'll be seeing some pretty significant escalation in energy costs, you know, for gasoline, for natural gas, for, you know, all forms of fossil fuel. And that's really going to fuel a very dramatic shift in focus. And people are really going to wake up when they're paying $4 or $5 at the gasoline tank.
For more information about all these things that Alex Wilson's involved in, just check out the website of Building Green at buildinggreen.com. Thank you so much, Alex. And to get a copy of this Enviro Close-Up or any of the programs of Enviro Video, just visit our website at www.envirovideo.com. I'm Carl Grossman. Thanks for watching.